You're doing great if I'm doing horrible in front of you.
Yeah, if somebody has 6 months of spring, you're doing great.
One of the questions you can never suggest. Although, if you got arms like that and a bowling like that.
So what we want to do is kind of show you guys, I mean a lot of people don't know of Mocello, or have heard of it, there's obviously a couple of large e-commerce packages for tobacco, some e-commerce, some e-commerce, and now the other ones. Mocello is quite a large e-commerce package, and it's because, you know, partly because of our own fault, or maybe not documenting it or showing it properly, we think people don't realise kind of the growth of what's happened over the past 12 months. Initially, or in the last, or at the beginning of the 12 months, we were getting around about sort of 2 installs a day. There were a few forks on GitHub. There were people fairly interested in the project. And as of today, we've kind of grown quite a lot. We're getting, on average, 10 installs a day. We've got 145 forks on GitHub. Literally 37 contributors. And from the people using it, there's, you know, from 64 different countries. And from the beginning, showing how active it is, we've had 33 version releases. So it's a very active project. I think that works out every 3 weeks.
Six weeks.
We've got a new version coming. So we're doing, it's very active, and we've got a lot of stuff going on with it. But we want to show you really, you know, how good the stats were. Obviously no fireworks like Neil's does, but you know, we're getting there. So what we're doing is showing this. The whole point of this is to kind of go over what the package does. I think what you've seen, or what most people have seen, is it's an e-commerce package. So it does sales, it does products, it does the stuff that, you know, typically an e-commerce package should do. It does all this stuff. You know, you can manage sales, you can manage products, shipments, you know, different customers, payments, the kind of stuff that you'd expect to have in an e-commerce package. But kind of what we want to do today is kind of run over in a bit more, not really in depth, but just show developers really kind of how far you can go with it. Because, as I say, it is a very large e-commerce package, and it is very scalable, and some of the things we're going to explain today.
One of the coolest things that's happened over the last 12 months is we're getting a lot more community feedback. We're getting a lot of pull requests. We're getting a lot of feature requests. And people noting things that were either missing or weren't complete. So one of the first ones that we addressed was the marketing module. We'll actually show you some demos of some of this stuff later. But we've made everything very pluggable. So we have an offer provider, which in this case is a coupon offer provider, which you can add a single reward to, and then multiple constraints, and structure the constraints in such a way that as the offer is analyzed, or as it's trying to be applied, if it doesn't pass any one of the constraints in a certain order, it'll either kick and say that no, this doesn't validate, or it'll go ahead and apply the discount. Another one that has kind of been there for a while is the reporting, but we did that as a plugin, just assuming that everybody would want to write their own reports respective to what they were doing. But it turned out that they started using the example reports, which were sort of done. So in the recent release, we've actually added more reports, put those, cleaned them up, added some graphs, and put those into decor. One of my favorite ones is early on in early editions, you kind of had to have a one-to-one relationship between a Marcello product and a piece of content to merchandise the project, so the product, so it would display on the front of the site. We've reversed that now, so in Marcello directly, you can select a bracket of content type, document type, attach that to a product, and therefore you can use pretty much any Umbraco property natively right on a product. So just rendering that product is actually done in virtual content. So we borrowed a little bit from nested content, archetype, those sorts of technologies. And when they are presented to a designer at when you're actually building out the templates, it's just iPublish content, so it's very, very familiar. Another thing was collections. So we looked at categories, you know, lots of e-commerce systems add products to categories, which seemed a little bit confining. So we looked at several different models, and Shopify actually had a pretty good one where you had the notion of collections, and you can either have static collections or dynamic collections. So a static collection can very easily become a category where you can manually add a product to one or more collections, and then you would render those collections as a category. You can use the static categories for other things, back office instance or whatever. And then dynamic collections are a functional collection where you can define some sort of method to render the collection wherever, and it kind of self-manages. So you don't have to manually add a product to a collection. An example of that would be actually ships with Marcello now. Under sales, we have unpaid invoices, paid invoices, partially paid invoices, fulfilled orders, unfulfilled orders, open orders, that sort of thing. So you have the full list. You click one of the collections, you'll see a subset. Again, all of these are really, really pluggable, so you can write your own collection and it'll just resolve.
I think that was a cool thing that we wanted to get across today, is how pluggable Marcello is really. Just because the stuff that's in there doesn't mean you can roll your own. You know, just because we've done something, it doesn't mean that it has to be like that. You've got code there, you can go and roll. It's all open source, you can just roll your own. Another thing that we've done recently is the Bazaar Starter t-shirt store. We've tweeted about it a bit on Twitter, and there's been a few screenshots put on the website for it. So one thing we realise is people want to test out Marcello, get up and running really quickly with it. So what we've done is, it's a very simple t-shirt store that you can install as a package, just like Umbraco. So once you've installed Marcello, you can just download the Bazaar Starter Kit, install it into Umbraco, and obviously run straight away the front end. It's just tied to Marcello. So it gives you a great chance to just, you know, get started quickly with Marcello, test it, you know, have a quick go, run around the back office. And also, what's good with it is all the source code's there. You know, everything's in our GitHub repo. This whole thing's completely open source, and that's something that we're really trying to push to get you know, some help with, and also so you can get started quickly, you can see how things work, you know, you don't have to worry about documentation, no examples. The full source code for Bazaar is there, so you can see how everything works, how we're getting products out of collections, how we're adding to the cart, you know, going through the checkout, you know, payment providers, everything's there, so you can get up and running. It actually also uses, I don't know if people are familiar with Articulate, it's Shannon's blogging platform. We borrowed the theme engine from that.
Yeah, shamelessly borrowed.
Yeah, so it's actually got a theme engine. It comes with this kind of bootstrapped front end on it. So you can actually, if you want to just run with this as a store for your client or yourself, you can literally just copy the theme folder and just skin it exactly how you would with Articulate. So you can have a store up and run very quickly with all the features that you'd expect when you've got the store. Right, so what we thought is we could waffle for ages, but unless we show you something, and we've seen that recently, is unless you see it firsthand, it doesn't make sense. So how we describe something might not be how you describe it. So this is actually the starter kit, the bazaar. Like I say, we reskinned it. As I say, it's a simple e-commerce store. It's nothing flashy. We have products with options. You can add your cart, you can check out, we have the usual stuff. So, yeah. Okay, so obviously the front end's not the done thing you want to see. So at the back end, actually what we've done there, we finished an order, so we'll go and see that in the back end in a second. When you install Mercello, it's done in the bottom. You see the icon, Mercello icon. Click that, and one of the big things that we're trying to do is Mercello's really tightly integrated with Embraco, really tightly integrated. Even from us trying to make your developer life familiar with using iPublish content or iProduct content, so you have the same familiar feel about the, get property value, you can use all those same kind of things that you would in Embraco as you do with Mercello. So we've given the same familiar feel, like most of the stuff that plugs into Embraco. So if you were to go to the products, the main settings are on the dashboard in front. This is the kind of place where you set up the store and you can set
global settings.
Going across the, we've got starting from top to bottom from the tree, we've got the products.
Can you guys see this?
Yes, I'm looking. This is. We've got on the right hand side here, one of the new things was relating, keeping the kind of nested content feel where you have a document type or content type you can then just choose to have on a product or a variant. So straight away what you see here is you can choose which document types or content types you want to relate with each other. Because you could have a site with a ton of them, you don't want to constantly pick from those. You want to just, it's a way of referencing and just saying this document type or content type you can use in Mercello. So when we go through to the next section, you'll see it makes your life a bit easier when you've got specific doc types you can pick from instead of having to wait through a ton of them when you do it. So the products down there on the left hand side, we've got the product listing, but on the side here, if you open up the products, this is the product collections that we spoke about. So these are on here, these are the static collections, so we've kind of created these to either mimic the front end of the site, so if you've got a category structure you can just mimic it, or you can kind of do what you want. If you wanted featured products, or it's open to how you want to manage your site really. You can also pull through collections and sub-collections in the front end and display them as a featured bar on the front of products, or just stick with categories. It's quite easy to do that. So if we go into an actual product now, so in the actual products themselves, we've got the kind of standard stuff that you'd see for e-commerce. Everything from putting prices, managing options, you can have obviously variants from the various options, adding it to a collection. We've got stuff here about shipping information. This is obviously useful when you can have custom shipping providers, which will run through in a second, so you can also set weights, dimensions, you've got complex shipping rules, put all those in. And obviously warehousing, that's something that's going to be extended later in Mercello. If you go to the extended content, this is what we just said about to the document type. So this is literally just taking the document type and it's just rendering it, and including the tabs as well, so you've got a familiar feel. So as you do it, it really is just a document type. So we have document type and it's just set as normal. So you can, once you've associated it, you can go and add other properties to that, and they will just appear in the extended content and just save it as you would normally. The one thing we do have in the extended content, which is it's multilingual. So if you've got multiple languages, it's very much like Vorto, the way where you can actually swap and you can change the languages. Your extended data as well. So what we we do have is those are product variants. Product variants are generated from the options. So if you just a combination of them to give each one. Now, variants also, they can have extended content too. So you can actually make really complex types of products. So you, with the variant, it's exactly the same way. This is the assigned document type you have. We choose it, and again, we need exactly the same feel that we get with the product. So we're taking it all the way through into the variants as well. The product options, again, this is how the variants are generated. It's, at the moment, it's just a simple way of adding, it's just a kind of key values. So you can add as many different combinations as you want to generate the variants that you need. Okay, sales, again, I think Russell touched on it there. Everything is collections. So we have collections in products, sales, and customers. So these collections are either dynamic or static. So you can see we have these ones here are dynamic collections. When we say dynamic, they're actually done in code, which is, again, this is something you can even change, add your own. It's really simple to do. So, you know, you could, for the sake of sales or customers, you could stick I want a dynamic collection in code that only shows orders, you know, that happened in Christmas that are over £2,000, and you could swap and change it out to your heart to intent, and it would just dynamically show and fill them.
Is that just a true answer?
The thing about the collections, which is kind of neat, is you don't necessarily have to have them in the tree. So what you can do is that there's configuration that you can take your collection and make it appear in the tree. Just through the Mercello config file, so our special configuration file. But there's a lot of use cases where you would create your own dynamic collection, so you have this like portable piece of code, and you can use reference that collection just to do different things with it. Yeah, good question.
So this comes with dynamic collection straight out. Again, you can go create your own whatever you want.
You can also add your static collections under here, so if you had something if you wanted to do, like problem sales or something, that you wanted to train your staff to keep just dump the quick sales into so you can quickly get to them, you can add as many different collections statically under products, sales, and customers.
We have the standard kind of things you expect to see in the sale for a sales, obviously. What we have got here as well is something that we've done in Razor with prefix invoices as well as custom prefixes. So if you've stored, you've got multiple stores with different to differentiate between the orders. It's something we're working on at the moment for a different store. So to be, it's one we've just done. We went through the checkout in that bazaar that you saw. That was a cash provider. So we've got different payment providers, Braintree, PayPal, etc. So all we need to do on that one is just capture the funds now and just confirm that we have processed that. Obviously that would be done via the payment provider, that would capture the funds because that's what it's there for. But we have to capture it because that's exactly why we've got the cash provider. So what we do also with those is we'll fulfill that now, which then we can put obviously tracking numbers, you know, how it's going, everything you expect.
Got multiple statuses, your warehouse. If you have more than one item and one isn't in stock or something, you can split this into multiple shipments, so you'll have multiple shipments.
Right, and also for the... So what we've done is something that we're working on is we're showing you a roadmap at the end. And again, this is a bit of a whirlwind tour that we're going through here, so there's a lot more features and bits to show you. This is actually going quite in depth, as I said, with splitting shipments, you know, and there's things that obviously, for example, like changing status of orders, you know, you guys can hook into those code-wise and do sort of a lot of different things with that. But the order noticing that we're trying to work on at the moment, so this is the idea is, you know, you want to keep a history. This is kind of back office stuff for users, so keep a history. You can have like a history of different notes on an order that's happened. Also, what we're adding at the moment is be able to find who actually added it. So you can see this, like, if you've got three or four people managing a store, you want to know who's put this comment on, And there's another side of it that we're looking at is having customer notes as well. So,
and payment notes, yeah.
And payment notes, yeah. So, you know, we can, visible to the customer, not visible to the customer, things that, you know, make it easy to communicate with them.
The super cool thing about the notes is it started, we didn't start it, so that was a completely community pull. Someone got in, understood the entire service layer repositories, built it in our pattern that we're using, and all of a sudden one day I get this gigantic pull request, and I'm like, holy smokes. And so we've been really taken off with it, so it's really good.
Yeah, and we've just literally run with what they've done, so it's great, you know, help like that. It's exactly the kind of stuff that we want for this project. So as much as you mentioned, like shipments.
Payments. So on this payment, you can void a payment, refund a payment, you can partially refund a payment. Most payment providers, the way that we build out our base process, we're trying to get everybody to do the void, refund, capture, authorize capture on each one. And then there's ways to inject different fees so that you can actually do these functions per payment provider. The void really just is more if you have made a mistake on your end, it's not going to go back and talk to the provider. The refund will actually, if you're dealing with some sort of API base, go back and do a refund transaction on that payment provider. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so obviously, as Rusty said, the shipments in this page, obviously we can split shipments, and we have a number of different actions that we can do from here. So obviously edit it, you can do status changes, part ship.
Edit the origin, edit the destination, after call again.
We'll do it. So the, again, collections managed, we use those to manage customers. Again, you can use dynamic collections, so you can do things like, actually I want to show you customers that have had orders over £1,000 only, so you can start and target those and pull those out of the system quite easily.
Or dollars.
Or, yeah, dollars, sorry. Yeah. So if we go through to customer, what we have done, some of the stuff we've been working on recently is the customers section. We're trying to not only to sort of think about developers, but what I've been trying to bring to this is I have people that manage stores, and I'm trying to figure out ways for them to be able to manage the back office and take it to the sort of remove their external workflows. They can do everything within the channel, really. Things like it was before we were running SQL on an old store, running SQL scripts to kind of see what people had in baskets when it was, trying to maybe contact them. So we've kind of upgraded the site here to be able to manage a lot of customers. You can manage everything from multiple addresses, shipping addresses. We've got a customer basket, so you can see exactly what it is that they've got in their basket. And don't forget, the good thing about this stuff is these are methods that we use in the system. It means that if you're programming or building your own site, you can make use of these methods where things like a weekly email reminder, this is all in here. So you can pull out a customer's cart, check how often when you get stuff that's been in a cart for 30 days, they haven't done anything, ping them a reminder email, all this stuff you can pull out and it's there. You can move them to wish lists, add products in directly from the back office here into their basket for them. And this is kind of the start of what we're looking to do, or what's going to be done in the next few versions, is you can actually check out through here for the back office. So if someone's got a customer on the phone, you can actually add stuff in their cart for them, change their addresses, and you can check out and even take a payment through the entire back office without them having to touch the front end. So it makes it good for people managing the site. We have sales history and customer notes. Again, customer notes has been upgraded to exactly the same what we're doing with the invoice stamp, the sales notes, where we're going to have multiple notes. And again, this is where we can have visible to the client or not visible to the client, so we can pull that through and stick it in front of the site. Obviously, multiple addresses that you can add really to it. The
marketing.
Yeah, marketing. So this section is, it appears small, and it's when people install it, they kind of look at it, and there's not really much marketing modules. The reason why is marketing is very, very complex. Anyone that's done e-commerce, guys, Anderson, Soren, they know it's very complex to do marketing stuff. So we've got, it ships with an offer provider. We give you, most people want coupons. that's kind of what they want out of the box. But again, what we're trying to get across and we want people to delve and have a look at is that this is all pluggable. You know, you can roll your own offer providers, you can do what you want with it. So, and you know, you've got the code there for the coupons, so you can see how, you know, most things done. So a coupon provider is actually quite it's quite complex itself. So we can have 10% off, we can have a reward, which is the 10% off, and then we can have multiple constraints. So we can say actually, you know, they have to have X amount of items in the cart or the basket for it to do it. Just the normal kind of stuff you'd expect for a coupon. They need it once, all those kind of things. Now, what's quite cool about those is these constraints are pluggable as well. So we've given you a load of constraints that we think that, you know, most people would have in e-commerce, but these are super easy to roll your own. So if there's a constraint that you want to roll, it's all interfaced. You can just run your own constraint, roll your own constraint, and pop your own one in. Makes it quite configurable, in our opinion, anyway.
Constraints in reports back. When you hit it, does it report back? So if I'm on checking out, I put my discount code in.
Yes, it'll get each one of those. If it fails back, if it fails on any one of the constraints, each one of those has a message that comes back. So it comes back in the result. So it's an attempt that gets applied, and if the attempt is successful, and if the discount line item is created, and puts it in there.
The volume of my discount, because I haven't hit.
So
like I said, I think the marketing service is, although it seems to some people quite, when they first install the channel, they look at it and decide it seems quite small, it's just like a coupon. In fact, if you delve a bit further, you'll see it's actually quite complex. And what the coolest thing for me is you can roll, you know, this is all in the code and you can just roll your own. What's even better is if you want to just take the constraints, you know, which are really easy to do as well, you can take what we've already done and build it. Yeah. It's still there.
So, kind of giving context on that, building the initial first few to get everything to resolve and do everything correctly, that took a few couple days, but when I went down and I flushed out these constraints, I was able to add 9 or 10 in about a couple hours. So it's just a pattern, you know, very, very quick process, so that makes it really flexible.
We touched at the beginning about the reports, so this is something that's new that's been added. We now ship it with 4 different reports, because it's something that was requested before, so we use Angular charts. Again, we've got this week versus last week. You can configure the dates in these as well, to, you know, your own date range. Now, again, I keep reiterating this, but everything is pluggable. So these are just ones that we give you. You can easily roll your own reports, and you can make them appear underneath, so the tree itself. So actually, on the reports, if you roll your own, then you can just open them up for the client or whatever, and initially will appear in the tree. Click them, and they've got their own view to see all the data. But we've got the normal sell guide, abandoned baskets, just sort of giving you. The problem with doing this kind of e-commerce is very large as well, so we can only do so much to give you guys a wide range of ideas and things to show you. You know, we don't know, everyone's different, everyone wants to see different data and reports, they're very hard. We're just trying to give you a starting point and something that you guys can look at and say, oh, that's how you did it, that's the interfaces you use, and kind of just run with it really. And if you want to obviously make some reports and ping them back to us, that's great.
Yeah, that would be great.
So the providers, we have gateway providers here. Now these are the kind of like
nuts and bolts,
the meat and potatoes of the e-commerce system. So we've got notification providers, payment providers, shipping providers, taxation providers. So obviously you all know payment providers, that's the kind of standard thing most people want. Shipping providers, things like USPS, UPS,
FedEx,
those kind of things. Now, everything that we do here, this kind of stuff, even the stuff we put in, we build it based on the infrastructure that you would use to build your own ones. So it all works the same. It's not like we've made something special, we just use the infrastructure there to roll out our own stuff. So, for example, the Braintree, once we've made the provider, we come in here and we can enable it, and once we've enabled it, in here, obviously, it has all the settings that you need for your payment provider. And once we've saved those, and we're ready to say, go to the payments tab, and in here, then you can add. This is from the the Braintree, you can add the kind of methods. So for the Braintree one, we've got like vaulted transactions, we've got PayPal.
Yeah, a vaulted transaction is where you have a customer, they have they're going through and they're saving, you want to save their credit card, so if they come back and they want to bill against the same credit card, Braintree allows you to save their credit card, but not in Marcello, it's saved on their API, and they give you a token, so you just basically bill against the token. And they've got PayPal built into it, they even have Apple Pay. It's really easy at this point, but the base that we have here is literally just JavaScript to add all these other different payment methods with Braintree.
So we're going to the providers. So the shipping providers, this is again something we're going to run through in a second with the roadmap. Again, you can write your own shipping providers, pretty simple to do that. It comes out of the box with a fixed rate shipping provider. If you want to run through that one.
Good. So this is a basic rate table shipping provider, but you can create either by weight ranges or percentage of sales ranges. You can and make a shipping rate table based off either weight range or total sale. In regions or countries that have regions like the United States, those are also convertible. You can do things like, I want to add $2.50 for everything going to Alaska, or $3.50 or $10, whatever you're going to do for Hawaii. And those are also adjusted by either percentage or $5 amount. So on any shipping provider, even like USPS, FedEx, or whatever, you could also adjust those rates to come back based off of the region if you wanted to. We'll touch on this in the roadmap, the notification provider. But there are a couple other taxation providers that have been built. TaxJar was done by FlightPath over in New York. Really good one. And I did early on in Avalara, which is another pretty big tax system. So you can get a quote. It actually does your tax documentation and all of that stuff. So that at the end of the whatever your period is, you send them a check and then they send in all the forms, that sort of thing.
So let's see, very quick overview there.
Yeah, if you guys have any questions in the right now, let's talk for questions in the back office.
I had a question.
Yeah.
Is there inventory management on the variant level?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So you guys can do like you have one red medium shirt kind of thing?
Yes.
Okay.
So over here, you would have the inventory, we have to turn it on. You have this, but also under the variants, if they have inventory, you can change the update the inventory on multiple variants from bulk action.
And then I didn't quite catch, it sounds like you've mimicked the content section in Marcello.
Yeah.
But does that also mean that you're essentially editing a content node from the content section in Marcello?
No, it's done a lot more like nested content. So
okay.
We take the property data and we, I think this is another shameless rip-off of pretty good code. So it's a key value pair that gets serialized in JSON stored into our own table. And then for every language that's configured in Umbraco, what we try to do is we try to say what you're doing in Umbraco and then use that as a configuration. And then you have two different records in that table for two different JSON sets.
Okay, cool.
What we'll do is just spin through the roadmap and everything just to see if we can get a couple of minutes of questions, but obviously we're here for the duration, so please come and speak to us. So if we spin back through, what we'll do is show you where we're getting to right now. So if you go up to the... So what we've done is we've actually put a little bit of a roadmap together. Some of the things we want people to be able to get up and running quickly, and we know the blocking for most people who are doing simple sites is they don't particularly want to have the pain to roll their own providers and make a PayPal thing, because it's kind of like they come out of the box and most stuff. So what we're doing is on version 2 is what we're working on right now, is a payment and checkout focus. So we're actually almost done with the Braintree payment provider, and these are proper fully featured. As we said, we've got volume transactions, everything, you know, refunds, everything in there. A standard PayPal one, and actually we're looking at Authorize.net and Stripe, so we may actually be able to get four in there, but we don't know at the moment, just so we're kind of covering the States and Europe and everyone.
Yeah, the customer notes, again, we're just going to follow the same pattern, do the threaded notes, extend them. But we'll do those on payments as well. So if you have multiple payments in, on an invoice, you refund it, you want to take another payment or something like that, you can make notes on each payment.
And the documentation, obviously, our aim is to keep updating the documentation as we go. So we've got 2.1, it's coming into the shipping focus. Again, same problem as everyone's having is that it comes with a big shipping rate provider, but most some people want to see other variations so they can use it to adapt their own and make their own. So we're going to do a FedEx, USPS, UPS one, and also for the message templates, which is for the notification stuff as well, notification providers, we're going to start using Razor Views, so you can use Razor for your templates, for example, if you were going to ping a order confirmation to a client, then you can use a Razor View and you can put in data.
So you can go get the images and put those in the email.
And again, part of it is documentation too, we do.
And just the FedEx, UPS, and USPS providers are actually already done by ProWorks. So we're going to take their forks, and they work really, really well. The problem is if you don't have an active project in something, it's very difficult to keep it up with the versions. So we're going to take their code, kind of make it a little bit more generic so that less repetition. And then those will be in the core,
So what we're doing now is to, after these versions, we're trying to help you guys out. We're also going to start offering training. So we're going to actually start offering training in the US and the UK. We're still working on that, and we're working in conjunction with Wrappers, trying to make our stuff actually work with theirs, so that we kind of, if you take the Wrapper training, hopefully ours will follow soon. But we will be running that to other countries, but again, this is definitely get things done first. And obviously, you know, we need you guys. This is an open source project, and it's big, as you may have seen. And so we need some help with people getting involved. We already have a lot of people involved, which is great, but obviously the more the better for us. You know, even just participating in the comments and the forum, doesn't have to come and fix, you know, a load of stuff for us or the functionality, just helping out in general, reporting issues, things that if you use it and see. Obviously fixes and checking out pull requests is always going to be very well received.
Make you a rock star.
Yeah. And the biggest thing is that we have, obviously, one thing we've been working on now is we have documentation finally, which is a big thing. So all documentation, it's on readme.io, so you guys can just go there straight away and spin through it. This is obviously always a work in progress. We are trying to update it. But obviously, the project's going quite fast. There's a lot of functionality. We are pushing forward. Secondly, then I'm going quick for time. Then also with this is, if you like the cello and you're using it or anything, we have a new website, and in there we've got some gratitude licenses. Or if you get really drunk tonight and you want to just spend some money, I'll break the joint. By all means, have a look at the gratitude licenses. It's all very well received. It helps us kind of polish the
billboard.
It helps us keep it polished and everything else, because as people who do e-commerce or big open source projects know, it's, you know, it's very time consuming, takes a lot of money to keep it going. Having a website, and then we were going to try and do questions at the end, see if you had any.
Is the documentation open source, so could I contribute to it?
Yes.
You can. Yeah. It's done with suggestions, and when you edit, it just is basically a fork of GitHub pull request, sort of, that we can check and make sure it's accurate and that sort of thing. But that would be awesome for documentation.
Anything else?
Yeah.
Are the customers tied into Embraco members at all?
Exactly. It's optional by member type. So if you can actually have Embraco members that aren't customers if you wanted to, or by member type, if you create an Embraco member, we use an event to trigger the customer creation. So if it's and it's coupled by the email address or the login name. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have there been any instances of people using Bazaar to create their own?
Lots, yeah. I'd like to say that, I know a guy down in New Zealand that must have 10 or 11 sites on the Bazaar, and he just... He's built a couple of New Zealand-specific shipping providers and payment providers that probably never go into the court. I've never heard of them, and New Zealand's pretty
full of sheep.
Yeah, full of sheep. From the
Aussies. Do you have an example of one of those sites that he built?
I don't know if I have an example
of his. Well, they've got some examples of Michelin sites on the front of the Michelin. There's six there we have. We have another couple which we're going to add, but we were trying to find ones which are just not like taking a Bazaar and look very similar to the Bazaar because it's just, you know, just reskinned. We're trying to find stuff that has really complex. So this guy here, this is the guy in England that's done this thing. This is all done with, you know, options and variants, I think, and it's super quick. That's another thing. Obviously, we need to examine the back end for, as well as obviously the database fallback, for products and options, so it can, you know, it is super quick going through it. But that guy there, if you look on the front of it and go through the configurations of how they're doing blinds and stuff, it is quite tricky, to be fair, and it comes back really quick.
Anyone else? Could you associate only certain payment providers with a given customer? So I have a situation where the client wants certain customers to only have certain payment options, and other clients have other payment options.
You could, that would be kind of an application thing. So the way that it would work is Marcello resolves payment providers that it wants to get, and then you would have to have some sort of rule set to say that I want to filter based off the ones that are being offered. So you would do it in a controller, or in a service, or whatever you want to do.
Anyone else? Here we go.
Cool. Okay, thank you very much. Cheers.